Problem 2. For each positive integer n greater than or equal to 3, we define an n ring to be a circular arrangement of n, not necessarily different positive integers, such that the product of every 3 neighbouring integers is n. Determine the number of integers n in the range from 3 to 2018, for which it is possible to form an n ring.
I think my first thought on reading the question is that I've got no idea what an n ring is. I've never heard of an n ring before. So I thought I'd try some small values of n to try to get a feel for what might an n ring look like. So if I try n is 3, what is a 3 ring? It's a ring of 3 positive integers, so that if I take a number and its 2 neighbours, they have to multiply to give 3. So I guess there are not so many ways to multiply 3 positive integers to get 3. They have to be 1, 1 and 3 in some order. So I might start trying the numbers 1, 1 and 3. In fact, that's already a ring of 3 positive integers, so I just need to check if I take a number and its 2 neighbours, do I always get 3 when I multiply? So here's a number, I multiply by the 2 neighbours, I get 3. Here's a number, I multiply by the 2 neighbours, I get 3. Here's a number, I multiply by the 2 neighbours, I get 3. So that is a 3 ring. That's a good piece of data. We know that if n is 3, there is an n ring. What if n is 4? So I guess then there are a couple of ways that I can multiply together 3 positive integers to get 4. So one of those would be if I had 1, 2, and 2 in some order. So maybe I have this. And now I need to put in one more number. I need a ring of 4 numbers. And looking at this 2 and its 2 neighbours, I'm going to need this to be a 1 so that this product gives me 4. But now if I look at this number and its 2 neighbours, those don't multiply to give me 4. So this is no good. This does not give me a 4 ring. There were other possibilities as well. So maybe for my attempt, I had these numbers in a different order. But actually, we can check that that's not going to work out either. So looking at this 2, I'm going to need this number to be a 2 as well. And now I have a problem here. So that doesn't work. I could also try having 1, 1, and 4 in some order. That would be another possibility. So for example, I could have 1, 1, and 4 like this. Now, this missing number, looking here, this product, I have to get 4, so I need this to be a 1. But now this number multiplied by its 2 neighbours doesn't give me a 4. So that's no good. I might have had 1, 4, and 1, for example, and it's the same sort of story. So here, looking at this number and its 2 neighbours, I need this to be a 1. And now this doesn't work. So we can check all of the cases and discover that there is no 4 ring. And we can do something similar when n is 5 and check the cases. So there are not so many cases because where numbers have to be 1, 1 and 5 in some order. So for n is 5, I might, for example, have 1, 1, 5. Now I've got a couple of numbers to add. So this number, if I look at this 5, I need its 2 neighbours to be a 1. If I look at this 1, it's already got a 5 as a neighbour, so this had better be a 1. That completes my 5 numbers. But now this 1 doesn't work. And you can check that if I have 1, 5, 1 or 5, 1, 1, that also doesn't work out. So there's not a 5 ring. So what have I learnt by trying these small examples? Well, I've learnt that there is a 3 ring, that there isn't a 4 ring, there isn't a 5 ring. I'm not sure that gives me enough data to make a kind of prediction about for which values of n there is an n ring. But I think I've learnt a little bit about how these n rings work. I think that's given me some ideas about how I might proceed more generally. Something I think I found when I was looking at the small cases is that if I know some of the numbers in an n ring, then that kind of forces the next number and forces the next number and forces the next number. And I think we might be able to use that more generally. So let's think about a general n ring now. So let's say the numbers are a1, a2, a3, a4, and so on, all the way around to an. By the way, I've labelled them like this because the number of numbers is unknown. If I knew there were 3 numbers, I might have called them ABC, or if there were 4 numbers, I could have called them ABCD, but I don't know what the nth letter of the alphabet is. So using subscripts solves that problem. It's handy notation. So if this is an n ring, I know that the product of each of these positive integers with its 2 neighbours must be n. So for example, looking here, I know that a1 times a2 times a3 is n. And looking here, I know that a2 times a3 times a4 is n. And I can keep going like this all the way around the ring until I get down to equations like an minus 1 times an times a1 is equal to n, looking at this number and its two neighbors. And then an times a1 times a2 is equal to n. And now that's kind of interesting, because if I look at these two equations, that tells me that a1 must be the same as a4, because a2 times a3 times a1 or a4 is equal to n. And everything's positive, nothing's zero here, so it's all fine. So these two together tell us that a1 is equal to a4. And then these two together, using a similar kind of argument, tell us that a2 is equal to a5. And we keep going like this. So this pair tells us that an minus 1 is equal to a2. And that feels like it must be pretty helpful. So what we've just seen, we could summarize as saying that ak must be equal to ak plus 3 for all k. Where here, I'm sort of wrapping around. If this subscript goes above n, I kind of wrap around again. And based on past experience, my hunch is that that means there are going to be two cases. Let me show you what I mean with a couple of examples. So if n is 5, for example, what does this equation tell us? This relationship tells us that a1 must be equal to a4, adding 3 onto the subscript. And now I add 3 onto the subscript again, but that would give me a7, and there isn't an a7. That's what I mean by wrapping round. So when we wrap round after 5, we're going to get that that's the same as a2. And now I add another 3, and that gives me a5. And now I add 3 again, that would give me a8. That doesn't make sense. I need to wrap round. That gives us a3. And actually, that tells us that if n is 5, and we've got a 5 ring, all of the 5 numbers must be equal. But if I think about a different example, if I think about n is 6, then I'm going to have that a1 is equal to a4. When I add 3 to this and wrap round, I get back to a1. So I'm not going to kind of keep going here. And I'm going to get an equation like a2 is equal to a5. And again, wrapping round gets me back to a2. And a3 is equal to a6. So here, in the case when n is 5, all of the numbers have to be equal. In the case n equals 6, we don't seem to be getting a relationship like that. We've just got kind of some information, but not that all of the numbers must be equal. What's the difference between 5 and 6 here? Well, the important thing is that 6 is a multiple of 3, and 5 is not a multiple of 3. If I start with 1 and keep adding 3s, the first time I kind of get back to where I started is when I've been through all of the numbers, because n is not divisible by 3 in this case. So let's see how that looks more generally. So the first of our two cases is when n is not a multiple of 3. And we know we've got this relationship that ak is ak plus 3 for all k. And our sort of feeling, based on looking at that example, is that that means that all of the aks, in fact, have to be equal. So how could we show that carefully? Well, if n is not a multiple of 3, there are two possibilities. It has to leave remainder 1 or remainder 2 when we divide by 3. And we can think about those two separately. So if n is 1 more than a multiple of 3, it leaves remainder 1 when we divide by 3, then n is 3m plus 1 for some positive integer n. So what does this then tell us? So we're going to get a1 is a4 is a7 and so on, all the way up to a3m plus 1. I'm just adding 3 for the subscript each time. This is, in fact, n. So now I'm going to wrap round. When I add 3 to the subscript, I'm going to get a3. And that's the same as a6 and a9 and so on, all the way up to a3m. And then when I wrap round, I'm going to get a2 and a5 and so on, all the way up to a3m minus 1. And in fact, these are all of the possible subscripts, and they are all equal, which is what we were expecting. And in the other possibility, where n is 3m plus 2 for some positive integer m, what does this look like? So we're going to get a1 is a4 is a7 and so on, all the way up to a3m plus 1. This is now n minus 1. When I add on 3 to the subscript and wrap round, I'm going to get a2. And then I can keep going. So I get a5, a8. And so on, all the way up to a3m plus 2. And then that gives us that that's equal to a3, and so on, all the way up to a3m. And similarly, we discover that all of these have to be equal. So if we have an n ring, where n is not a multiple of 3, then all of the numbers have to be equal. But we also know that we've got this property that a number times its two neighbours must give us n. So we know that that fixed number we've got all the way around multiplied by itself, so that number cubed, must equal n. And that narrows down the possibilities for what n can be significantly. Let's take a look. So let's summarise what we found in the case that n is not a multiple of 3. So we've said that if n is not a multiple of 3 and we've got an n ring, all of the numbers have to be equal, and we need the number that appears all the way around to be the cube root of n. So if n is not a cube, then they can't possibly be an n ring. And that fits with our experience when we tried n is 4 and n is 5 earlier on. If n is a cube, well then there is an n ring where I just have the cube root of n all the way around. You can check that if I take n copies of the cube root of n all the way around, that does give us an n ring. So we're going to count those later on, but first of all, let's do the other case where n is a multiple of 3. So our second case where n is a multiple of 3, I think we can learn from our experience with n equals 3 earlier on. So I think there is an n ring. So if we take the triple 1, 1, n and just keep writing it round, because we know that n is a multiple of 3, I'm going to be able to write this triple an integer number of times round the ring. So I've got n numbers in my ring. And if I take any three numbers that are next to each other, they're always going to be 1, 1, and n in some order, so their product will be n. So if n is a multiple of 3, there is an n ring. So what we have to do now is count the values of n in the range we're interested in that give us an n ring. So we want to count the number of values of n between 3 and 2018 for which there is an n ring. So let's think about the multiples of 3 first of all. So we know that every time n is a multiple of 3, there is an n ring. So we'd like to count the multiples of 3 between 3 and 2018. Or we could do a quick calculation and find that 2018 divided by 3 is 672, remainder 2. So there are 672 multiples of 3 in this range. And then we also want to know about the cubes. And I guess we only need to count the cubes that are not multiples of 3, because any cube that is a multiple of 3 has been covered here. So I did a little calculation earlier, and I think that 12 cubed is less than 2018. But 13 cubed is bigger than 2018. So I think that the cubes we're interested in are 2 cubed, 4 cubed, 5 cubed, 7 cubed, 8 cubed, 10 cubed, and 11 cubed. And there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 of those. So that gives us an extra 7 values of n for which there is an n ring. So in total, I think the number of values of n between 3 and 2018 for which there is an n ring is 672 plus 7 is 679.